and just the time I need him, he's always here. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart.
Leading through all the
Jesus, my
95.
Do, 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 do. Come, all ye chosen saints of God, whose souls are washed in Jesus' blood, hear what he says, his word is true. My great sufficient is for you. Almighty bread.
255. Oh, that's good. 255. 255.
Good morning. Great blessing to gather together this morning and to worship our Lord, our risen Savior. Thankful for all those who are with us. Thankful to have some visitors this morning and want to welcome you and welcome you to come back and join with us each Sunday as we meet together to worship and to look into God's Word. This morning, I want to share a brief comment and text with you, and then we're going to go to the Lord in prayer and ask our pastor, Elder Steve Wilkinson, to come and speak to us. You know, as the Apostle Paul writes by inspiration to the church at Thessalonica in 1 Thessalonians, he recounts the encouragement that he's received from their faith in Jesus Christ, from their having received the gospel and believed the gospel. And as he says these words, what he writes is, "Knowing, brethren," in verse 4, "your election of God, for our gospel came not unto you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Ghost and in much assurance, as ye know what manner of men we were among you for your sake. And ye became followers of us and of the Lord, having received the word in much affliction with joy of the Holy Ghost, so that ye were in samples to all that believe in Macedonia and Achaia. For from you sounded out the word of the Lord, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place your faith to Godward is spread abroad, so that we need not to speak anything. For they themselves show of us what manner of entering in we had unto you, and how ye turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, which delivered us from the wrath to come." I know that's a lot of reading, but as you think about this, what Paul is saying is the crux of the matter is you became believers in God and Jesus Christ. You became believers, you turned from idols, false gods, to serve the living and true God. And in so doing, you committed to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead. There's a lot of talk about the resurrection and the fact that Christ raised. But what I want us to consider and realize is that the fact that Jesus Christ is risen necessitates the belief that he's coming again. And what Christians the world over must confess and must believe is that Christ is coming again, that he's alive. We're expecting him to come again. And that expectation mandates some changes in behavior on our part. It mandates that we live in that expectation. We live our lives believing that Jesus actually is alive. Now, I'm afraid sometimes when we contemplate the idea of resurrection, we think about it in the past tense. We think about some events that happened around 2,000 years ago. We don't think about what it means today. But as we read the scripture and how the resurrection is spoken of and how Jesus Christ is spoken of, he's spoken of as a living, reigning Lord. And that's what Christians the world over have believed, is that Jesus is alive today. And what does that do? Well, it changes their action. What does he say about these individuals? "Our gospel didn't come to you in word only. It came in power, in the Holy Ghost, and much assurance." Where's the assurance? Well, the assurance is that because he lives, we shall live also. Because Christ rose from the grave, it means that he was successful in what he came to do. What did he come to do? Well, the angel told Mary, he shall save his people from their sins. So as we read this expression of the Holy Spirit through the Apostle Paul, we find out that when we actually understand the gospel, when we actually understand the message that is given, what we understand is that there is assurance. There is assurance found in Christ, the living Lord, and it changes who we are. Because you believe this, verse 6 says, "You became followers of us and of the Lord, because you received the word in much affliction with joy of the Holy Ghost." Understanding this truth, receiving this truth, enables us to endure affliction with joy. So maybe things in your life aren't going the way you wish they would. Maybe there's hardship. Maybe there's struggle. You can face that struggle, that difficulty, with joy in the Holy Ghost. Why? Because you know that Christ is risen. You know that Jesus Christ is alive, that he's aware of what you're going through. In fact, in the Hebrew letter, the apostle writes and says that we don't have a high priest that can't be touched with the feelings of our infirmities. Jesus Christ knows what we're doing, knows what we're going through, knows what we're suffering. and he's able to make a way of escape from even the most grievous temptation, the most grievous fears. So what happened? These people changed their course of living. They followed Jesus Christ because they believed he was alive. And they became ensamples to all them that believe across a wide region of that part of the world. And he says not only that, but the word of the Lord sounded out from you. It went forth. A church that is healthy, a Christian believer who is healthy, is one who is going to have the word of God sounding forth from them, not by plan and by intent, but by living in that faith, that trust in Jesus Christ, because our behavior will show that we have received the gospel. It'll show that the Savior is alive, that he's active, that he's taught us. I love how in the Ephesian letter, the Apostle Paul, writing to the Ephesian church, reminds them, but you have not so learned Christ. You haven't learned Christ the way the world might teach him. You haven't learned Christ in some intellectual way because you've been taught by him. You've been taught of him. He has taught you. The Holy Spirit is active, is real. You turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God. The gospel calls each of us to turn to God from idols. We all have idols in our life. That precious hymn that Doddridge wrote says, "The dearest idol I have known, whate'er that idol be, help me to tear it from its throne and worship only thee." The apostle here writes by inspiration, you turn to God from idols to serve the living and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, which delivered us from the wrath to come. Past tense, the work is done. He delivered us from the wrath to come, but in the present and the future, we serve him rather than idols. We live to serve him. The Church of Jesus Christ, from the time of his resurrection till today, meets on the first day of the week, at least. Once a week, the first day. Why? Because that's the day he rose. And we observe every day a risen Lord. Why? Because we interact with him. We pray to him. Those aren't just words we speak. When we say in Jesus' name, we're speaking because we believe that Jesus Christ is alive. That's something to rejoice in every day. So again, I welcome all of you who are here with us, whether it's the first time or whether you come each week. But we would love to have you each week come to worship our risen Savior with us and to rejoice in this work that he's done in each of our lives. I trust in your life as well. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Almighty Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. Father, we thank you for each one that has come out to this place to meet together and, Father, to worship you and, Father, to worship your Son, Jesus Christ, in accordance with the revelation of your word. Father, we ask that you would be with Brother Steve as he stands before us, that you would empower him with your Holy Spirit to speak words of truth, and, Father, words that would be impactful, that would actually change each one of us as we interact with those words, as they touch our hearts, as they touch our minds. Father, we ask that you would apply the word in a very real way, that you would change us, that we might serve you more faithfully, that we might repent of our sin, that we might confess our sin to you, and, Father, find that you are indeed faithful and just to forgive us our sin, to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Father, make us more holy, make us more fit to serve you and to honor your name. Cause your word to go forth from this place and your people to hear it, to receive it, to believe it, to be changed by it. Father, I ask that you would give us a commitment to serve you every day, and, Father, that you would cause your house to be filled with those who would worship you of a ready mind and of a free heart and spirit, and, Father, that you would cause your name to be magnified in this place. We thank you for our pastor. We thank you for each of our members, and, Father, just ask that you enable us to labor together in your kingdom and to magnify your name. We give you praise. We give you thanks. In Jesus' name, amen.
Turn with me, please, to the 15th chapter of the book of 1 Corinthians. Very happy to see all of you here this morning. It's a delight to see the Weltons back from Panama. Yeah, we spotted you, and we're thankful that you're back in God's country again. Amen? Glad to see you. Along with all of you who are here, you're here for the first time, welcome, and we're thankful that you're here and hope the Lord will bless you. for making the effort to come and to be in the house of the Lord. Paul writes in chapter 15 of 1 Corinthians concerning an error that had crept into the Corinthian church. There are probably 11 to 13 different errors that were in this church. And they, frankly, that most Christian churches would have already thrown them away and said, these people are not Christians and they just got too much error in them. But when Paul addresses them in the first chapter, he calls them the church that is in Corinth. So he still calls it a church. And that means there can be a lot of error. Doesn't mean it's okay to have a lot of error, but it means there can be a lot of error and it still be a church of the Lord Jesus Christ. And you know why? Because it's filled with sinners. Amen? Amen? Amen. We're filled with sinners. And this particular error is the lack of belief in the resurrection. Now, most of the world, Christian world for sure, recognize this day as a day of Christ's resurrection from the dead. I want to echo what Brother Joseph said about the celebration of the resurrection is every time that we meet, right? Because the basis, the center point of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ is around his resurrection. It hinges on whether he was raised from the dead or not. Now, would you say that being raised from the dead would be a miracle? Yes. Yeah, that's exactly what it is. And those that would detract from this truth would say it's not possible naturally for that to happen. And that's true. Naturally, it's not possible for it to happen. But I guarantee it's possible because a lot of people saw our risen Lord, which we'll try to get to in a moment. We want to go here and some other places. Would you please pray that the Lord will guide our minds this morning? I need it a lot this morning. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you. Paul had already preached in our series going through the Acts of the Apostles. You recall that we have mentioned that Paul made his trek up into Asia Minor and then over into Greece and Corinth before he started back to Jerusalem, where I left you in Jerusalem last Sunday. So this is part of that. He said, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you. And what he's saying is I'm not changing my mind. I'm not changing themes. I'm not changing truths. It's the same gospel I preached to you when I was with you. Inconsistency is always a sign of error. It needs to be the same gospel every time. And we don't change the gospel upon the whims of men. The truth of the gospel is that Jesus Christ is Lord, amen, and that he is our only Savior. The salvation is only through Christ, not Christ plus anything. Anything you add in addition to Christ, you've added something to the gospel. So I'll read on to you, please. Which I preached unto you, which also you have received, and wherein you stand. They still consider themselves a Christian group of believers who believe in Christ. They are known as a church of the Lord Jesus Christ. So they're standing in this truth, but they wavered on some of our basic principles. And this one is a major departure. Would you not agree? By which, let me read the first verse again. Moreover, I declare unto you the gospel, which I preached unto you, also you to have received, wherein you stand, by which also you are saved, if you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. Sometimes people have a little trouble understanding that text. I don't. But I'm going to tell you this. I'm very thankful, Jason, that I am not saved based on my ability to keep things in memory. Amen? Amen? Y'all with me on that? But there are some things that we can forget in the gospel that will deliver us emotionally, deliver us spiritually, deliver us in an intellectual way. If we keep them in memory, keep these things in memory, then they are things that will deliver us from pitfalls in life, from misunderstandings in, say, marriages, or in the rearing of children, and all those things. These truths that are contained in the gospel will save us from tremendous error in our lives. Amen? And so the salvation of consideration is a salvation through the gospel, but it is a salvation of deliverance from ignorance to understanding. And when we forget them, when we forget the principles, then we cease to be saved from that error or that problem. Then when we remember them, we're saved from it again. Oh yeah, the scripture says this, and we get back on track. Paul's desire for the Corinthian church is to be back on track. He's not writing them saying that you're no longer a church because you've departed from this basic principle. He's writing them to save them from the error that they're making in their understanding. So he says in verse 3, "For I delivered unto you," this past tense, "I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures." Did you notice how he wrote that? "I delivered to you what was delivered to me." Now, when Paul was on the road to Damascus, he got introduced in a very magnificent way unto the Lord Jesus Christ. Struck down, Saul of Tarsus, big man in town, had all this authority from the Sanhedrin to bring into bondage people who believe like you and I do this morning. And God struck him down, showed him that he was not a big man, showed him who was the boss, and saved him from his ignorance. Amen? And so when he says, "I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received," I received the truth from the same source you're going to be receiving the truth from, or that you received the truth from, how that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. Now, if he died for our sins, are our sins died for? Yeah, common sense, right? Did it accomplish what he intended for it to accomplish? When he died on the cross, what was it? What was some? There are a lot of words that he said from the cross, but what are the ones that you remember the most about it regarding this verse right here? "It is finished." He finished the work that he came to do. Did he not? Yes. Salvation is a reality because of what our brother just said. Through the blood of the everlasting covenant that Christ shed upon the cross. Now, he either did it or he didn't. What do you believe? He did it. Didn't try to do it. Didn't almost do it. Didn't get it almost to the last step, and then you got to take the next step. Oh no, that's not salvation. Salvation is a completed work. And what Paul is saying here, that I taught you what I learned, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. That is, the Bible said that he was going to die for our sins. Psalm 2. He died for our sins. Isaiah chapter 53. He died for our sins. And then it says, and was buried and rose again the third day according to the scriptures. Y'all believe that? Amen. Just a hint. It's very difficult to get 3 days and three nights between Friday and Sunday morning. And I don't want to upset a friend or friends in other denominations, but I just want to just remind you that it was more likely Good Thursday than it was Good Friday, or maybe even Good Wednesday, because he was actually crucified and buried on Wednesday evening. According that works perfect, and that's according to the actual calendar days that the Passover was at that time. It's another subject. But he was buried and rose again the third day according to the scriptures, just like the scriptures said that he was. Remember in Matthew chapter 13, then they said they were asking him about his what he's doing and what he's trying to do, and he said that you people need a sign. In fact, they were saying, if you are the Christ, give us a sign. He said, an evil and an adulterous generation seeketh after a sign, something that you can tangibly touch. People always And I watch these YouTubes myself, okay? I watch YouTube, all right? I confess. They think they found maybe where the Ark is located, Ark of the Covenant. Or they think they found where the Noah's Ark is, etc., etc. But the believer in Christ doesn't need something tangible. They've got a more sure word of prophecy. They've got something that's in their heart that's more real than the tangible, that tells them it is the truth. Amen? I've never seen an ark. I've never seen the River Jordan back up to the city of Adam. I've never seen any of that kind of activity. I've only read about it in God's word. But my heart tells me that when I read that, friends, that it really happened. Isn't it interesting how it is that somebody can read the same thing you read and say, this is myth, this is fairy tale, but you read it and weep like a baby and rejoice in the glory of God. You know why? Because some folks are born again and some folks are not born again. And the born again, when they read God's word, it bears testimony to what is already in the heart, and they rejoice in a Savior's love. It's glorious, isn't it? And if I don't hurry, I'm not going to get to all the substance of what I want to talk about. But notice he says in verse 5, and he was seen of Cephas. Cephas is another name for the Apostle Peter. His name was Cephas, and then changed to Peter. Then of the 12, after that he was seen of above 500 brethren at once. Now, that's remarkable, isn't it? You know, he was 40 days on the earth before he ascended back to glory, just 10 days before Pentecost. He was on the earth 40 days and appeared to many. And according to Paul, historically it's documented that above 500 brethren at one time saw the resurrected Lord. That's amazing. This is not somebody who claimed to say, oh, I saw him. You know, and they make up all this kind of vision of what they saw and make up the story and elaborate on their story. No, this is 500 brethren that saw him at one time. And they could say, did you see that? Yeah. Did you see that? Yes, we saw that. Can you imagine the interaction between over 500 brethren at one time seeing the nail prints in his hands and in his feet and the wound in his side and to look upon his visage and actually see the same Lord that had been buried was alive. Paul said above 500 at one time saw him alive. This is 54, around 54 AD when this was written. Probably about 20 years or so after all that occurrence. And he says, of the greater part remain unto this day. Now, let's just say it was 500, even 500. Okay? It says above 500. Let's just assume that it was even 500. That would mean there were at least 251. That's the greater part of 500, right? Right? That's above halfway. Remain unto this day. Paul is saying to the Corinthians, there are 251 at least, probably a lot more, that you can go to and ask about it, and they will tell you the occurrence and tell you what he looked like and tell you that they saw the nail prints in his lovely hands and feet, maybe even the wound in his side. Paul is saying there's way too much proof left from the crucifixion and the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord for you to be denying the truth that he's raised. And I'll just say, you know, we need to be reading our Bibles. No amens are necessary, but I'm going to tell you, you'll be surprised how quick the truths of God's word will slip away. And you'll forget. And people will call me, they'll text me, what was that text that says something about this or this? And I have to, you know, contemplate for a while. I think they mean this text. And I'll zip them the text back on, and they say, that's it. And maybe if we read our Bibles a little bit more, we'll have a grasp on where things are in God's word. That's not speaking disparagingly toward the Lord's people. Let me tell you something, folks. If I don't read regularly, I forget too. God's people need to take this valuable book that we have and eat it spiritually in our lives. So he was seen above 500 once, above 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain unto this present, but some are fallen asleep. Some have died, is what he means by fallen asleep. And after that, he was seen of James, who I believe was the pastor at Jerusalem. Then of all the apostles, and last of all, he was seen of me also, as one born out of due time. And I am the least of the apostles, that I'm not meet or worthy to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. Will anybody here would like to stand up and say, I am worthy to be here. I'm worthy to have this truth. I'm worthy to be able to rejoice in this because of my good work. Anybody want to stand up and say that this morning? You don't, do you? Because you know you're not. Paul is just saying what you say when you compare yourself to the living Savior. We are nothing and less than nothing, comparatively speaking, to our Savior. Amen. Now that'll pop your bubble, won't it? Yeah? And so, he said, by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace, which was bestowed upon me, was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God, which was in me. That is, our labors that we perform in service to the Lord Jesus Christ in our life, we can only do them by the grace of God. Amen? I need grace to be able to pray for you. I may not go to all of your homes. I did recently, went to a family's home with them. What a time of rejoicing it was. But don't you think I'm not praying that the Lord will bless you and hold you together and hold you up, because I am. Now I want to go to the book of Luke for a moment in connection to something, some of the things that we tried to speak on in that verse. And I want to notice, please, in verse 50 of the 23rd chapter first. Behold, there was a man named Joseph, a counselor. He was a good man and just, and the same had not consented to the counsel and deed of them. He was of Arimathea, a city of the Jews, who also himself waited for the kingdom. Now, I would say this is a spiritual man, wouldn't you? I'm glad we don't have to wait for the kingdom. As my Father hath appointed unto me a kingdom, even so appoint I unto you, that you may eat and drink at my table. We're in his kingdom now. And we're eating and drinking in his kingdom in the house of God. And he was waiting for it. And most Jews did wait for the kingdom. And that Joseph of Arimathea was sensitive and sympathetic to our Lord. That tells me something about him. That Joseph of Arimathea didn't like what they were doing to our Savior. This man went to Pilate and begged the body of Jesus. And he took it down and wrapped it in linen and laid it in the sepulchre that was hewn in stone, wherein never a man before was laid. And that day was the preparation of the Sabbath drew on. And the woman also, which came with him from Galilee, followed after, and beheld the sepulchre, how his body was laid. And they returned and prepared spices and ointments, and rested the Sabbath day according to the commandment. Now notice, please, on the first day of the week, thank you, Brother Joseph, for saying it, the first day of the week, we do meet and worship the Lord Jesus Christ in respect and in honor and in glory to our resurrected Lord. Amen? And when you go through the Acts of the Apostles, Paul did meet occasionally on the seventh day or the Sabbath day when he went to the synagogues. But when they assembled as the church, it was always the first day of the week in respect and honor to the resurrection. And on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came to the sepulchre, bringing the spices which they had prepared and others with them. And they found a stone rolled away from the sepulchre. So this kind of rules out the idea that the first people who came to the sepulchre got their shoulders to the wheel and pushed it aside and opened it up, you know, and I'm going to pretend that he rose from the dead. That didn't happen. It says they found the stone rolled away already. Because they wanted to let, he just really swooned, you know. You know I'm being terribly facetious right here, don't you? You know, he really didn't die. He just kind of went into a brief coma because of all the abuse. And so they opened up to roll the stone away to let him out. No. The Bible tells us in Matthew and in Mark that the stone was rolled away, but what it was rolled away for was to show you that the tomb was empty already. It was to show an empty tomb. Our Lord didn't need somebody to roll the stone away. He just came out of the tomb victorious. That's glorious to think about, isn't it? I mean, when he appeared to his apostles on occasion in John, where we go over to the Gospel of John, he just appeared in the room with them. He could go right through the door. They were locked in, afraid because of the Pharisees, and he just appeared in the room with them. More than one time that he did. And even Mary, bless her heart, when he was speaking to her when she was weeping at the tomb, she didn't even know it was him till he revealed himself to her. It was amazing. The glorified body of the Lord Jesus Christ could do that. But the stone was rolled away once again to show that the tomb was empty. And they entered in and found not the body of the Lord. And it came to pass that they were perplexed about, they were therefore perplexed about, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. Two guesses who these two men are. First one, don't count. Angels of the Lord. And they were afraid and bowed their faces to the earth, said unto them, what seek ye? Why seek ye the living among the dead? He is not here. He is risen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was in Galilee, saying, the Son of Man shall be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day arise again. And they remembered his words and returned from the sepulchre and told these things to the 11 and to the rest. It was Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary, the mother of James, and the other women that were with them that told them these things to the apostles. And their words seemed to be like idle tales. Now think about it. It viewed the awful condition of our Savior as he was beaten and then beaten and disfigured, so hardly recognizable as a man, and then nailed to a cross and in agony rising, trying to force himself up on the nails in his hands and in his feet to get a breath, and then sinking back down and pushing yourself up to get a breath and sinking back. That's what your Savior endured for you and me. He loved you, and as they mocked him from the cross, if you be the Messiah, come down from the cross. Save yourselves if you're really him. I'm going to tell you, friends, I don't relish the fact that my Savior suffered like he did. Do you? It's awful to think about a man who never did anything wrong or anything bad, only good, and only taught good things from God's word, could suffer like that. But he did. And you know why he did it? For me. For you. But even that suffering was not even to be compared to the suffering of 3 hours on that cross. When the sun refused to shine on the scene of our Savior, and he was made to cry out, "My God, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. My God, why hast thou forsaken me?" Quoting back from Psalm chapter 22, very first verse of it, hearkening back. And what Jesus was doing was hearkening back and reminding them of what Psalm 22 was. It was a picture 1,000 years before he ever was crucified. In detail, David writes it in the Psalms. And he's alluding back, this is what David was talking about. And that was the awful death that man put on him. But when it was dark, then Almighty God poured his wrath out upon him. The wrath that would have been on you and you and me. The eternal wrath of suffering that would have been upon you was on him, because our sins were laid on him. And if our sins were laid on him and he paid for our sins on the cross, that means they're paid for. And they can't be held against us. So, about two of them, of the apostles, went the same day to the village called Emmaus, which was from Jerusalem about 60 furlongs, and they talked together about the things that had happened. Well, that would be normal. I mean, you're talking about, man, did you see what happened? Did you see how it got dark for 3 hours? Did you see what they did to our Lord that we followed? Did you see how they abused him? No telling what all they talked about, but they visited about it. And it came to pass, as they communed together and reason, Jesus himself drew near and went with them. They didn't have any idea who he was. But their eyes were holden that they should not know him. And he said unto them, "What manner of communication are these things that you have one to another as you walk and are so sad?" One of them, whose name was Cleophas, answered and said, "Art thou a stranger in Jerusalem? Hast thou not known the things which have come to pass in these days?" And he said unto them, "What things?" Now, he knew what things. He was the substance of what occurred. "What things?" And they said unto him, "Concerning Jesus of Nazareth, a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and crucified him. We trusted that it had been he who would have redeemed Israel, and besides all this, today is the third day since all these things were done." Makes sense, don't it? The third day, he's with them. "Yea, and certain women also of the company, made us astonished, which were early at the sepulchre, and they found not his body. And they came saying that they had seen a vision of angels and said he was alive. And certain of them which were with us went to the sepulchre and found it even so, as the women had said, but we saw him not. And he said unto them, O fools, and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken, ought not Christ to have suffered these things and entered into his glory? He was supposed to suffer these things. Psalm 22 said that he would. Ought not Christ have suffered these things and returned into his glory? And as they drew nigh, verse 28, to the village, whither they went, he made as though he would go further, that is Jesus. And they constrained him, saying, abide with us, for it is toward the evening, and the day is far spent. And he went and tarried with them. And it came to pass, as they sat at meat, or listen, are you ready? He was a absolutely phenomenal teacher, the Lord was. Would you agree? Are you still with me? He took meat with them and took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave to them. Now, do you remember a time before that this happened? When he instituted the communion service on the Passover, his last Passover, he took bread and broke it and gave to the apostles. And he gave it to them, and their eyes were opened, and they knew him, and he vanished out of their sight. And notice what they said. And they said one to another, did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us by the way, and while he opened to us the scriptures? He started from Moses and the prophets and told the story of the Lord Jesus Christ through the Old Testament. And their hearts were burning from the truths of the words that he spoke to them. Did not heart burn within us while he talked with us, while he talked with us in the way, and while he opened to us the scripture? Does your heart burn spiritually when you read about it? Does it make you long for him? I hope it does. It means that you have Christ dwelling in you. That's why you have. Now, there's some kind of heartburns I don't like, okay? good Mexican food sometimes will do that to you, right? Right? That's not the kind of heartburn it's talking about now. We're talking about a spiritual heartburn. That our hearts are burning with joy and love for the God of heaven and for the Lord Jesus Christ. One more thing I want to bring to your attention from chapter 20, the first day of the week again, chapter 20, verse 1. Mary Magdalene. Where was Maggie? I saw Maggie earlier. She's a namesake for this right here, Mary Magdalene. And it was yet dark, darkened unto the sepulchre. And she seeth the stone taken away from the sepulchre. And she runneth and come to Simon Peter, said to the other disciples, whom Jesus loved, that is John, said unto him, they have taken the Lord out of the sepulchre, and we know not where they've laid him. Somebody stole the body of the Lord away. Peter therefore went forth, and the other disciple, that is John, and came to the sepulchre, and they both ran together And the other disciple, John was a faster runner than Peter. We know that about that. That's an important point. But you know what? John hesitated and Peter went on into the tomb. So Peter came first into the sepulcher in verse 4. And he stooped down and looked in and saw the linen clothes lying, and he went not in. Then cometh Simon Peter and following him, and went into the sepulcher and seeth the clothes lie, and the napkin that was about his head lying with the linen clothes wrapped together in a place by itself. I've done this, Brother Larry, a couple of times when we've been out to eat. I've illustrated this. He's shaking his head. It was a custom in this culture that when you were eating, if you needed to get up and leave the table, that you would fold your napkin neatly, put it in a place by itself, and you'd leave the table, do your business, whatever it was, and then you would come back. Because they knew in that culture that if you folded that napkin, that meant I'm coming back. Right? Did I get it right, Brother Larry? Yes, sir. Guess what? He left them a little cultural sign. They didn't put this in there just to take up space. They didn't put the fact that the napkin of his face was folded in a place by itself in there just to fill up space or just to give little details that are of no consequence. This is in there to let you know that Jesus was letting them know by a little sign that he left them, I'm coming back. And it says, and they went in also that other disciple that first came, John, and he saw and believed. And as yet they knew not the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Now they had been told by Jesus that he would rise from the dead. You'd think they'd get it, right? Well, don't be so hard on them. Because you read scriptures all the time and you forget about them and I forget about them. So, you know, give him a break, okay? He had forgotten that the Lord had told him that he was going to rise from the dead. And then Mary stood at the sepulcher weeping. She really loved him. And you don't have to go and depart from the scripture and think about some kind of nefarious connection between Mary and the Lord Jesus Christ. That's stupid. She just loved him. I hope that we love him enough to weep for him. When we sing about his crucifixion, when we sing about his suffering for me, a wicked sinner, and it doesn't make us weep. It's surprising, isn't it? That's how many times we just sing for the sake of singing. But if we really think about what we're singing, we'd all be singing with tears rolling down our faces. Mary loved him. And she was at the tomb weeping. And she wept and stooped down and looked into the sepulchre. And two angels in white, clothed in white, one at the head, the other at the feet of the body of Jesus, where Jesus had lain. And they said to the woman, why weepest thou? She saith unto him, because they've taken my Lord away, and I know not where they've laid him. And when she had thus said, she turned herself back and saw Jesus standing, and knew not that it was Jesus. Now we're talking about a resurrected Jesus. This kind of gives you an idea that we're not going to be We're going to be the same, but we're not going to be the same on resurrection morning. The graves aren't going to hold us, my friends. When the Bible tells us over in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 that the graves will open, we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord are going to be witnessing the graves opening all around us. You say, Brother Steve, am I going to know when the resurrection morning comes? Oh, yeah. When graves start opening all around you and under you and around you, you're going to know it's a different day than it ever has been before. Amen? When we arise. And we're going to arise and be like the Lord Jesus Christ. Just like him. And fit and prepared to live in heaven's pure world. And she didn't know it was him. And when she had thus said, she turned herself back and saw Jesus standing and did not know it was Jesus. And Jesus said unto her, Woman, why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou? She supposed him to be a gardener. Said unto him, Sir, if thou be born, have you borne him hence, or if you've taken him away, tell me where thou hast laid him, and I will come take him away. And Jesus said, Mary. He didn't have to yell at her. He just said, Mary. I want you to understand, sometimes the Lord speaks to us in a still small voice. Maybe when you're stepping over the line and he says, Steve. And you know better than to take the next step. Steve. And it may not be audible, but it'll be his voice and you'll recognize it. And it'll be the voice of somebody who loves you and cares for you. And he said, Mary, and she turned herself and saith to him, Rabboni. That is to say, Master. She recognized him. If you're a child of God, folks, you know the Savior. You know when he's dealing with you. You know when he's talking to you. You know when he's leading you. You know that he's there with you in times of trouble and trial. You can feel his presence with you. Because you belong to him. When he opened her eyes, when he said her name and opened her eyes, she knew exactly who it was. And it says, Touch me not, for I'm not yet ascended unto my Father, but go to my brethren and say to them, I ascend unto my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God. Now there's a whole lot of stuff to preach about that verse, but it's almost 12. And I'm hungry. And it'll take me 30 minutes to explain what just happened when he said, touch me not. But he meant, don't touch me. Because I'm not yet ascended unto the Father. But I'll give you a hint. You want a hint, Sister Carol? Y'all want a hint? Aaron, you want a hint? All right. Go read Leviticus chapter 23. About the Passover, and then the feast day that just follows the Passover, and it would explain that Jesus had to do what he just said. I go to the Father, and to your Father, and my God and your God. I go to him, and he privately went back to glory and presented himself. The perfect sacrifice for you and me. And he said, don't touch me. Somebody that was not part of the Levitical priesthood could never touch a sacrifice. Don't touch me, for I'm not yet ascended unto the Father. You go tell them that I ascend to my God and your God and my Lord and your Lord. That's the truncated version of it. But go read Leviticus 23 and rejoice with me, if you will. God bless you. I love you so much for Christ's sake. He's risen. Amen?
Amen.
Let's sing a resurrection song. What's just a resurrection song? There are lots of them, right? He is risen. Low in the grave, up from the grave he arose. Let's sing that one. Y'all know that? Low in the grave he lay, Jesus, my Savior.
Yeah.
thank everyone for coming and being with us in the service today. And visitors that are here for the first time, we hope you'll come back and be with us as well. Do we have comments, announcements that we need to make? Brother Larry, you got one?
Well,
at least one? Do it, brother, do it.
The prayers that you asked on behalf of that man, until the Lord answered those prayers, been a positive act.
Woo! Amen.
Her doctor's appointment Thursday, and she said, I thought I would never hear, and it was remission.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woo!
Now you got me so I can't talk. He's still on his throne. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Brother Steve, if you wouldn't mind, and this is a little unorthodox, but this actually leads perfectly into this. And I step up here to ask for this prayer request because I know the mics don't always pick it up for the live stream, and I know that those are some watching that have a special love for my grandfather. And this ties in perfectly to the power of prayer that I know that this church specifically and those around us, the Lord hears our prayers, as small and feeble as they may be or as loud and mighty as they are. This past week, my grandfather, Elder Larry Webb, had his biopsy results returned, and he's been diagnosed with stage 2 prostate cancer. It's just kind of really swept us off our feet. None of us were expecting it. I know that there are those out there that watch the live stream that can't be here that love him with just an unbounding love, and I would ask that you please pray for him. The doctors are very hopeful, but he's just at that age where his treatment options are limited. Please continue to pray for him. Please pray for our family. And we know that the Lord can deliver him, just as he's delivered Sister Ashley and continues to deliver her every day. We know that he is able and mighty and just, and his will be done. But please pray for him.
Brother Larry is a very fine, gentle servant of God, which we love and appreciate here. And I can assure you we will be in prayer for him and your dear grandmother as well. Others? Yes, sir. Okay. All right. Thank you, brother. Others? Am I missing something? I'm seeing hands, but I don't know. Yes, sir. Awesome. Y'all hear that? Out of the mouth of babes, praise comes out. Amen? Amen.
We're babes.
Yes, that's right. Others?
Communion in 2 weeks.
Communion in 2 weeks. On Saturday evening, 6 o'clock. See you here. Brother Larry, will you come and lead us in prayer, in closing prayer, please. Good time to do it, brother.
If you'll bow with me. Our Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning. Lord, just thanking you for all you do. We have so much to be thankful for, Lord. And we know that you are still sitting on your throne. and providing for our needs, Lord. And, oh, Lord, we ask that you bless Elder Larry Webb and his family. Bless the doctors that are to treat him, Lord, and ask that you would bless him with an outcome to be your will, Lord, to return him back to his health, Lord. And, Lord, we ask that you continue to guide, guard, and direct us. Bless us in our needs, Lord, and continue to forgive us our many sins. In Jesus' name we pray, and amen.
Amen. Thank you.